Tantor Audio, a division of recorded books, presents Right Place, Right Time, The Life of a Rock and Roll Photographer by Bob Gruen. Narrated by Bob Gruen. Publisher's note. In this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. For my grandchildren and everyone everywhere, in the hope that they enjoy the freedom of rock and roll. Introduction. Bob had the ultimate backstage pass. He was backstage with all these bands. Can you imagine the stories he's got? Alice Cooper. One sunny day in 1979, I was crammed into a small rental car with a young heavy metal band called Riot. We were driving across Texas from one show to another. I was telling them stories about my life as a rock and roll photographer, and the driver was listening so intently that he missed our exit. The next exit was now 50 miles away, so that little mistake added 100 miles and 90 minutes to our drive. But nobody in the car seemed to mind. They just said, "Tell us more stories, Bob." Until then, I had never realized just how many great stories I had and how interested people were in hearing them. I took my first concert photos at the 1965 Newport Folk Festival, when Bob Dylan famously shocked the world by going electric, camped at the Woodstock Music Festival, met John and Yoko at an Aretha Franklin concert and became their friend and personal photographer, drove Tina Turner's Jaguar down the Pacific Coast Highway in a fog so thick I couldn't see the road, was at CBGB's for the birth of the New York punk scene. I documented Salvador Dali making the world's first moving hologram of Alice Cooper, became friends with the notoriously wild Keith Moon, drummer for The Who, toured with the ever-colorful New York Dolls, rode the bus with the Sex Pistols for their ill-fated American tour, and took pictures of Led Zeppelin members posing like rock gods in front of their jet plane. And those were just some of the stories up to that day in Texas in 1979. Since then, I've collected a lot more, having a long and hopeful conversation with John Lennon just 2 nights before he was murdered, living for close to a year in Japan and connecting with the rock scene there, flying with Green Day in their private plane, and hosting Joe Strummer on my couch. Just about every music fan knows my photos. They've seen them for years on album covers and posters, in books and magazines, in art galleries and museums. Some of them are iconic. The picture of John Lennon in the New York City t-shirt, The Clash on a rooftop with the Empire State Building behind them, The Ramones in front of CBGB's, Tina Turner whirling across the stage. The history of rock and roll is captured in my archive of many thousands of images, more than half a century of rock culture told in one classic image after another. Those photographs, however, show you only what I saw. Right Place, Right Time is about how I grew as a person, from a young kid with no particular agenda, with a camera and a passion for capturing the moment, to a professional photographer witnessing the evolution of generations of musicians who have come and gone, never quite made it or succeeded beyond their wildest dreams. For me, this book is not just about rock and roll. It's about freedom, the freedom to express your feelings out loud. My focus has always been to communicate that sense of freedom, the passion and the desire to be fully in the moment. Tommy Ramone once said that in order to create a successful rock and roll band, the image and the sound must gel. Punk author Legs McNeil, please kill me, concurred, "You have to have a great song, but you also have to have a great image to go along with it. There's the style, the swagger, the show, the song. But rock and roll also needs an image, as much as it needs a guitar and a mic." And this was even more true before the YouTube era, before the internet existed, even before Rolling Stone published its first issue. In small broadsheets and fanzines, on album covers and concert posters, the image has always been what helps draw the fans to the concerts. To me, my photos aren't just pictures, and the artists in them aren't just acts. I wasn't visiting the rock lifestyle as a journalist. I was living it. I've been lucky enough to work, travel, and become friends with many of the greatest artists in music. They became my extended family, my wonderful, crazy, wildly creative, and sometimes dysfunctional extended family. Like any family, we've had our ups and downs, experienced one another's triumphs and tragedies, and attended one another's weddings, birthday parties, and funerals. I've lost some of my most inspiring friends, John Lennon, Joe Strummer, Giorgio Gomelsky, Joey Ramone, so many, too many. But I made new ones as well, Billy Joe Armstrong, Supla, Jesse Malin, the unofficial mayor of the Lower East Side. Because these people are my family, my stories about them aren't the usual ones. I know them as wildly talented, three-dimensional, and oftenly perfectly ordinary people. My career has given me an intimate perspective that I hope comes through here. I reflect on taking the first photos of John and Yoko's baby, Sean, going shopping with Tina Turner, and watching her cook dinner for her kids. Sitting at the bar in CBGB with Johnny Rotten right after the Sex Pistols had broken up. And I'll never forget Debbie Harry kissing me on New Year's Eve in 1979 in Glasgow. All the time I hear from young people, I want to follow my dream. In right place, right time, I'll share what following one's dreams means to me. It means believing in yourself, giving up security, and taking chances. It means getting out there and living your life loudly. My own dream was simple. I wanted to take good pictures, to go to interesting places, and meet fascinating people. Someone once asked me and Malcolm McLaren, the manager of the Sex Pistols, how we had planned for our success. We both said, plan? Malcolm summarized this attitude well. When you go to sleep at night, you have plans for the next day. The next morning you wake up, the phone rings, and your plans change. You make the best of the day, every day. It takes courage to live like that, every day unplanned, with unexpected turns. But you have to do it if you want to follow your dreams. It's a matter of being in the right place at the right time, and then you have to do the right thing. That isn't something you can plan. You have to follow your instincts and try not to second-guess yourself. That is how I've always lived my life. Growing up in a typical suburban home on Long Island in the 1950s, I saw Elvis on television and listened to rock and roll on Murray the K's Swingin' Soiree, an all-night radio show that I tuned into under the covers in bed with my parents sound asleep in their room next door. My twin passions, music and photography, were born at the same time. By the age of 5, I was spending hours in the darkroom with my mother, an attorney who was an amateur photographer. I got my first camera when I was 8, and I had my first picture published in a local newspaper when I was 13. Still, in my house, photography was considered a hobby, and in the wider world, rock photography didn't exist. My parents expected me to graduate from college, get a secure job as a businessman, start a family, and live the American dream. Instead, I dropped out of college at 19 and moved to Greenwich Village in 1965. I did not have a career plan. My plan was to turn on, tune in, and drop out and live with a rock and roll band. So that's what I did. I arrived in New York City as a naive young man, ready to start having adventures and learning the ways of the city. There were some very lean years, but I could survive on a 25-cent hot dogs and a $1 bottle of wine. At the time I started, and really for most of my career, photographers were servants in the music business, merely there to provide adequate images of an event. Their identity is inconsequential. If I wasn't there to pick up the phone when someone called, then they just called the next photographer on the list. The competition was fierce. My career advanced one contact and opportunity at a time. I'd go to a concert, then to a few clubs, check out what was going on there, then to an after party or perhaps another late night club. But I took my camera with me everywhere. Then I'd go home driving along the Hudson River at sunrise and head straight into the darkroom and develop my rolls of film. After a short lie down, I'd make prints and take them around to the magazines and record companies. And then, that night, I'd go out and do it again and repeat the whole cycle. I did that for decades. Following your dreams is hard work. I owe a lot of my success to the fact that many of the musicians I met and photographed considered me a friend. As Yoko Ono said of me, John and I felt he was sensitive. In those days, photographers were all so pushy, and he wasn't. His photography shows what his character was, and that's what's so beautiful about it. I put my camera down when someone didn't want their picture taken, and I never gave much direction. Some of my best pictures are of musicians in a dressing room or at a party, in the backseat of a car, or on the street. I got those pictures because I was out there, all the time, open to chance, to the moment, to letting things unfold, and they were relaxed enough around me to be themselves. Bob's best pictures are the ones offstage, Iggy Pop said. They're important for what they document about the interaction between the people in them. You get a lot of information about either what these people were really like or what games they were playing. And my passion for music and for the people who make it comes through in my pictures. They're not always technically perfect. Sometimes the focus is soft or the figure is blurred, but the feelings are clear. I want to capture the spirit and the passion of the moment. I'm in my early 70s now, and I still go out most nights, happy to be sober and hang out and photograph old friends and new. I know I've changed over the years, but the passion that I started with for capturing the moment is as alive within me as it ever was. And the drive to keep going, to keep photographing, keep documenting the world in which I live my life, remains undiminished. I still get as excited looking at a newly taken photograph as I did when I was younger. I still feel a shot of adrenaline when I look at a particular image and think, that's the one. Chapter 1, Where It All Began. Donovan and Joan Baez, Bob Dylan. In July 1965, the Newport Folk Festival was the place to be. As Bob Dylan said, the times they were a-changin', and folk music spoke to young people who wanted to be a part of that change. American combat troops had just been sent to Vietnam that March, and thousands of young war protesters marched on Washington. At the same time, the Reverend Martin Luther King Jr.'s freedom marches were attacked by police and state troopers in Alabama. It was a tumultuous time, and music, not just folk and rock, but R&B, jazz, everything reflected that. And I was just one of the millions of kids who wanted a front row seat for the revolution. That April, I got a minimum wage job at the World's Fair in Flushing, Queens, selling film and flashbulbs. I just moved into my first apartment in Manhattan, in the area below Houston Street that's called Soho now, but was part of Little Italy back then. So I was just one among the thousands who saw the list of performers who were going to be at Newport and really wanted to be there. I was already into folk music, or at least I had an acoustic guitar that I could strum, and I sang songs by Bob Dylan, Pete Seeger, Phil Oakes, and others, all of whom were going to be at the festival, along with Joan Baez, Donovan, Mississippi John Hurt, Buffy St. Marie, and Peter, Paul, and Mary. The music spanned the folk spectrum. While some of the performers sang traditional folk songs, others, Pete Seeger, Joan Baez, Buffy St. Marie, performed their own compositions, new, topical songs that spoke to the changing times. And why? Because they sensed, as we the audience sensed, that music mattered. If you wanted to send a letter, you used the mail. If you wanted to deliver a message, you set it to music. And Newport was where everyone would hear that message at the same time. I just had to be there. But I couldn't afford tickets, which I think were $5 a night. I had no connections to the music press, no musician friends who could put me on a guest list, no reason at all to receive any kind of preferential treatment. What I did have was a friend of my mom's who ran a public relations firm who was willing to give me a letter saying I was there to represent them. It was a long shot, and it was not true. His company had nothing to do whatsoever with music. But with the optimism of youth and that letter in my hand, I quit my job at the World's Fair, and because I couldn't afford film any more than I could afford festival tickets, I stole a pack of 20 rolls of film on my way out. Around 100,000 music fans descended on the quaint seaside town of Newport, Rhode Island, on the weekend of July 22 to 25. Thousands of them camped out on the beach, and that's where I pitched my tent, too. When darkness fell, cold winds swept across the water, and I was chilled in my suede jacket, jeans, and cowboy boots. People built bonfires to crowd around, and we would gather for hootenanny sing-alongs. Becoming a part of the crowd was easy. Actually getting into the festival was a little more complicated. I made my way to Fort Adams State Park, where the festival was staged, and presented my letter at the press office. Obviously, they had never heard of me or the company I claimed to be representing. Their first reaction was to turn me away. But I remember something my mom had always said. Never take no for an answer. Instead, it can be the beginning of an interesting conversation. I was persistent, and they were very busy, with all the other journalists and photographers demanding their attention, and they finally agreed to give me a photo pass. And that was it. I was in. Camera at the ready, I was free to roam wherever I chose. The audience was already in position. Thousands of folk fans facing the stage in rows of folding chairs. Comparing that vision to the scene a year or two later, it was a very staid event. The hippie scene was barely beginning. Guys were starting to grow their hair a little longer, but they were still wearing shirts with collars, like the Beat Generation, khaki pants and tweed sports jackets. T-shirts wouldn't become ubiquitous for a few years yet. The girls were wearing their hair long too, but straight down their shoulders and backs. They wore loose-fitting tops and jeans. None of them looked like proto-revolutionaries, but their hearts and their voices were already in the right place. With my pass in hand, I was able to go backstage, where I saw Buffy St. Marie playing an acoustic guitar, singing her anti-war song, Universal Soldier. I stopped dead, just watching her. I was a huge fan, I knew all the lyrics, and when she saw me mouthing the words, she smiled and invited me to sing along with her. But I couldn't, I was too stunned. To me, Buffy St. Marie was the sexiest person at the entire festival. I just stood there, awestruck. But I got good pictures of some of the performers, though. Pete Seeger, Ronnie Gilbert, Donovan, Joan Baez. Then it was time for the star of the festival, Bob Dylan. His rock and roll, not folk, album, Bringing It All Back Home, had been out since March and had long since sent shockwaves through the folk music scene. Rockin' songs like Maggie's Farm and Subterranean Homesick Blues had very little to do with folk music, but his lyrics were as sharp as ever, sharper, in fact. I was completely enthralled. I was driving in my car the first time I heard Subterranean Homesick Blues on the radio, and I was so electrified by the words and images that flew through my head, I had to pull the car over and just listen, trying to absorb it. The last line, "The pump don't work because the vandal stole the handle," whirled around in my head for days. Then, just a few days before the festival, Dylan's new single, Like a Rolling Stone, came out. It hadn't been on the album. It would be on the next one, Highway 61 Revisited. But that was not the only surprise. The song felt endless. It was more than 6 minutes long, at a time when no single, certainly no hit single, had ever gone over 3 minutes. Clearly, whatever Dylan had in store for Newport, it was not going to be traditional folk music. The sun had just gone down as Dylan strolled onto the stage and the stage lights came up. He looked so cool. He looked like a rock star. He was often described as scruffy looking, but he came on stage in Spanish boots, tight black jeans, a black leather jacket, and under it, a really unusual orange shirt with a tab collar that was fastened, but no tie. You have to understand, that in itself was an act of rebellion. Nobody wore a tab collar without a tie. Nobody but Bob Dylan. It looked so wrong, but on him, it just looked right. In fact, the outfit might have been the thing that put off the folk fans in the audience even before he started playing. That and his stance. He looked like a rock and roller. As he and his band, a pickup group mostly comprised of members of the Paul Butterfield Blues Band, played the long, jangly Like a Rolling Stone, about half the crowd started booing, while the other half was cheering. Then they got to yelling at one another. It was chaos. Nothing like this had ever happened at Newport. Butterfield and the Chambers Brothers had already played an electric set of traditional blues, and everybody liked them. But for Dylan to do it, that was sacrilege. Dylan, clearly upset, stopped playing and left the stage. I headed around to one side. Peeking through the fence that stood around the backstage area, I watched as Peter Yarrow, of Peter, Paul and Mary, pushed an acoustic guitar into Dylan's hands and begged him to go back out and play some of his old hits to mollify the crowd. He did go back out to sing Maggie's Farm, and fittingly, It's All Over Now, Baby Blue, a familiar ballad that calmed the crowd down. But the damage had been done. The folk scene was never the same after that night. The times really were a-changing, and I think everybody there felt it. The message that Dylan once sang quietly with an acoustic guitar was now being shouted out above a loud, driving rock and roll beat, and the mostly clean-cut crowd simply didn't know what to do with it. To me, it was clear that Dylan was announcing that the folk music of America was now rock and roll, and that the young generation wasn't going to be quiet and polite anymore. The night Dylan started rocking out on stage, Sunday, July 25th, 1965, was also the start of my life as a real rock and roll photographer. Luck and timing would forever play big roles in my career, never bigger than being at the festival on that night. Dylan changed a lot of people's worlds, but he changed my life. He showed me what was possible if he just went out and did it. Chapter 2, Growing Up, Mom and Dad, Great Neck Fire. As a kid growing up in Great Neck, Long Island, I'd been into photography for as long as I could remember, and I have my mom to thank for that. Both of my parents were lawyers, but my dad went into real estate, building houses, and my mom specialized in immigration. She opened an employment agency that arranged for people to come from Europe to work in America. After a recession in the mid-50s, my dad opened a travel agency to complement my mom's business. She was also president, or honorary president, of a variety of different organizations, business and philanthropic. But her hobby was photography. She never took more than family photos, me and my brothers playing on the beach during vacations, visits to relatives, and so on. But she had a good eye, and she bought herself some great equipment. My family, my parents, my three brothers and I, lived in a suburban house, and when I was 5, my mom built a fully functional darkroom in the pantry of the kitchen. Some of my earliest memories are of the two of us in there in the red-lit darkness and the acidic smells of the chemical solutions of developer and fixer. She taught me how to process film and how to count off seconds while the film was developing, because you can't see a clock in the pitch dark. And I got to be very accurate at counting. My mom gave me my first camera, a simple Kodak Brownie Hawkeye, for my 8th birthday in 1953. I soon discovered I was good at taking pictures, framing, timing. Even better, it was also something that was all mine, not my older brother Richard's. In our family, he was the genius straight-A student. Photography was where I could excel. I soon took over as the family photographer, snapping photos of visits with aunts, uncles, cousins, Richard's bar mitzvah, and other family events and gatherings. I could not have known then that these early assignments would become so important to me later. After all, taking family portraits is a lot like taking a band's picture. You have to get everybody together and in the right mood all at the same time. You have to make sure everyone is looking at the camera and is engaged with the moment. You have to make sure nobody's head gets cut off. Maybe it's not so surprising that the music world became my family. I received my first grown-up camera from my own bar mitzvah. A friend of my parents, Harry Fink, owned a large camera store, Haber & Fink, in New York City. He gave me a 35mm camera, a Kodak Pony 2, and also discounts on supplies at his store. The new camera was still rather simple, but it was far more advanced than my Brownie Hawkeye. I could focus it and set exposures. I carried that camera everywhere. I especially liked action shots in my high school's football games, dances, anything where something was happening. Whenever I heard sirens, I'd run to see what was going on. I had a drive to see exciting things and tell people about them, to show and tell. One day in the summer of 1959, Friday, June 19th to be exact, as I was coming out of my mother's office in Great Neck near the Long Island Railroad Station, I was startled and excited to see fire engines pulling up outside a burning building nearby. I got pictures of firemen climbing up a ladder to the second floor, but I only had a few shots remaining on the roll, so I ran home, which was about a half a mile, grabbed more film, and sped back on my bike. A local photographer, Mike Miata, was now on the scene, taking pictures in front of the building. So he had that covered. I wanted to get the scene from a different angle, something I would do throughout my career. So I went into the 6-story apartment building behind the one on fire. I ran up the stairs to the roof. From there, I got shots of the whole scene from above. I hurried back home, locked myself in the darkroom, developed the pictures, printed a few of them, and rushed them to the local weekly newspaper, the Great Neck Record. I'm still not sure what made me think that they'd want a picture from a 13-year-old kid. All I knew was that I had a great shot, and my age shouldn't matter. The editor liked the one shot, but he wanted a better print. I went back home again, made a new print, dodging and burning, upping the contrast, and I took it back to the editor. I gave it to him, told him a little bit about myself, and left. It was only then that I realized I felt hot. My breathing was normal. I was no longer sweating from all the biking. But it turned out that all the exertion had brought on a full-blown fever, and I would spend the next 2 days sick in bed. It was worth it. I woke up the next morning and saw my picture on the front page of the local newspaper. The caption, the photo above, was made from the apartment house behind the fire scene by 13-year-old Robert Gruen of 25 Oak Drive. Bob is in the photographic business with Stephen Rutt, 14, of 1 Wilbur Drive, a classmate of his, in the 9th grade at South Junior High. He made this photo with a Kodak Pony 2 35mm camera, but he's hoping soon to have a Leica. The business part was a stretch. Perhaps that's why the copy department put it in quotes. But I was a bit of a budding entrepreneur. Steve and I had been friends since third grade. He was the skinniest person I've ever known, his clothes hanging on him like a scarecrow. He was already a genius inventor, always creating the most elaborate science projects, while the rest of the class was still oohing and eyeing about the same old baking soda vinegar volcanoes. Steve and I once put together a pump, tubes, and a timer to build a rainforest where it actually rained every 20 minutes. We used to go shopping for parts on Cortlandt Street in downtown Manhattan. Before they built the World Trade Center, a lot of little Army-Navy surplus stores were there, so that's where we'd go to get vacuum tubes, capacitors, and other electronics. We became partners. I took and developed the pictures while he invented things like a strobe flash for my camera that is still the best I ever used. We called ourselves Coast Photographers, and that's how the record credited the front page photo. Mike Miata's picture, by the way, was on page 12. As it turned out, he would be the first photographer I worked for as an assistant. I continued to take pictures through high school, as well as at rallies for local political candidates. One year, when I was about 15, the images used on the campaign posters for both the local Democratic and Republican candidates were my photos. High school itself didn't interest me too much. I was considered one of the nerds. The only place I shined was in the theater group, where I was the AV guy in charge of the sound and lighting. I was also the guy who would show the movies and slideshows in your class, because I knew how the equipment worked. Music was always a part of my life growing up, but never as much more than a background. I sang along with the songs I liked. I had my favorite performers. I bought 45s like any other kid. My parents were not at all interested in music. The only record I ever remember my father liking was by the Talbot Brothers of Bermuda. And while my mom's Uncle Joe was a jazz musician, I didn't meet him until much later. I did enjoy Miles Davis. I've been a fan forever. I must have been 7 or 8 years old when I first heard him, and I was immediately swept away by his music. One of the first records I ever bought was Kinda Blue. It was so beautifully smooth, soft, and meditative, and when my school gave me a trumpet to play, I was happy. I remained a trumpeter for 3 years, until my orthodontist pointed out that the trumpet was pushing my teeth back and I needed to wear braces. I also enjoyed the Weavers and Pete Seeger. In fact, they were the ones who first showed me how music became a force for something more than mere entertainment. Pete Seeger played at my elementary school when I was around 13. Pete sang about peace and love, individuality, and workers' rights. He had the audience singing along in three-part harmony, and everyone went home smiling. Just a few days after the show, there were letters to the editor of the local newspaper complaining that the school had allowed a communist to perform. It seemed incredible to me that a simple folk singer could be accused of being a communist, of trying to subvert the system, simply for singing songs of freedom. For the first time, I found myself thinking about the incredible power of music, what it meant, what it was saying. I began to pay more attention. Chapter 3, The Emerald City, Hank Aberle and Al Lax, Justice League. One day in 1963, when I was 17, my good friend from high school, Mike Gale, came to my house with a record. He said, "You've got to hear this." When he played it, my knees went weak. I fell to the floor laughing. "This guy is not a singer. What is this?" I couldn't believe that Mike was so into this nasal caterwauling. Who the hell is this guy? It was Bob Dylan. Mike told me to listen to what Dylan was saying rather than the sound of his voice. And when I did that, suddenly it made sense. Dylan's lyrics soon became my Bible. He was saying things that I didn't know I felt about myself and the world until he said them. A couple of years later, in the same room, I played a Dylan song for my mother. "It's All Right, Ma, I'm Only Bleeding." Was filled with dark, surrealistic imagery like disillusioned words like bullets bark as human gods aim for their mark, make everything from toy guns that spark to flesh-colored Christ that glow in the dark. It's easy to see without looking too far that not much is really sacred. I don't think Mom got it, but I did. I was inspired, so I bought an acoustic guitar and taught myself the basic chords to play folk songs. It was also Mike who taught me how to straighten my curly hair. Mike was African-American, and while he didn't straighten his own hair, his mom did hers, So he knew all about Permastreet, the hair relaxer. I went over to his house, and he put the goo on my hair. It smelled like formaldehyde and stung my scalp. When we washed it out, my hair was slightly rubbery, but absolutely straight. I was thrilled. Having grown up seeing Kooky Burns on 77 Sunset Strip and the guys in the Brill Cream commercials with their hair blowing in the wind, I loved having straight hair. Even better, as it grew longer, a lock of it curled down around my eye, which I thought looked very cool. My dad, on the other hand, thought I looked like a girl. I didn't care. Before going to bed each night, I'd comb my hair back and wear a stocking cap to keep it straight. I continued straightening my hair until 1969, when a hairdresser friend convinced me to stop, and he cut off all the straight parts. From now on, you'll never need a comb or a brush, he told me, and he was right. I've enjoyed naturally curly hair ever since. As I was finishing high school, my parents, like all middle-class suburban parents, wanted me to go to college and get a degree in something I could use to make a living. I had no interest in any of that. I wanted to take pictures, meet girls, and surround myself with interesting people and artists. I did try college several times. Southern Illinois University, CW Post on Long Island, and Baltimore Community College. But it didn't work. I was bored and restless every time. In fact, the only things I learned were lessons that would serve me well in my desired career. In Illinois, for example, I took pictures for the college newspaper, and I learned how to hold my liquor. In Baltimore, I became a regular at a music club for the first time, but certainly not the last. My first love, unsurprisingly, was a folk music club that I went to pretty regularly, even though I didn't have any money to pay for the admission or buy drinks. I went there just to be there and hang out, and after a while, I became friendly with the guy who ran the place, and he started to let me in for some of the shows. I remember seeing Tom Paxton play there and getting to talk to him afterwards. When I mentioned that I was driving back to New York that weekend, he asked me if I could give him a ride. So I drove Tom Paxton from Baltimore to Greenwich Village, the first of many musicians I would offer a ride to in my career. The other thing I remember about Baltimore was having fierce arguments with a racist sociology professor who said he wouldn't allow Zulus with spears to take over the streets of his neighborhood. We were arguing one day when he suddenly told me, "Why don't you just go to Greenwich Village and smoke pot with the hippies?" He meant it as a put-down, but I thought, good idea. I dropped out of college in the early spring of 1965, and I came home to Long Island, and I got that job at the World's Fair selling film and flash bulbs. It wasn't the most glamorous occupation in the world, and it paid minimum wage, less than $60 a week. But I was 19, and a dollar went a lot further in those days. You could drive around for 2 or 3 days on a dollar's worth of gas. Hot dogs cost a quarter. A bottle of wine was a buck. Alan Nevins, a guy I knew from Great Neck, had a Manhattan apartment, a one-bedroom with a living room and a kitchenette, on Sullivan Street, between Spring and Prince Streets. Or at least he did until his father made him move back home. Mike Gale and I moved into his apartment that June. Shortly after, Alan's father changed his mind and threw him out again, and Alan moved back in with us. The rent was $125 split among the three of us, although he didn't pay $125 because we could never manage to come up with that much money. That would soon lead to problems, but for the time being, we were settled. New York City at the time was and still is amazing. It lives, a vast organism with its own heartbeat, and always something new to discover. Kids still come to the city to be bowled over, and they are. Places may change, stores may disappear, but it's still New York City, a place where you can leave your past behind and invent a new future. I used to wander Greenwich Village alone for days on end and never tire of the sights, sounds, and smells. There was music everywhere, coming from the basements and windows and doorways. The omnipresent aroma of incense and pot and who knows what. Even now, no matter how many times I walk the narrow cobbled streets around the village, it never grows old. There's always something new to see. I discovered so much more music there than I might never have heard in Great Neck, like the Mothers of Invention. To this day, I remember Help I'm a Rock, a track from their very first album that sounds like nothing I've ever heard on another rock album. There, too, I was introduced to the music of the Holy Modal Rounders, who I regard as the first ever punk band, and the Fugs, whose music was a collision of rock, poetry, art, and protest, was seminal in my life. Hanging out in Washington Square Park one day, an established meeting place for countercultural types of all persuasions, I met two girls named Fritzy and Pixie. They were on their way to a club called The Scene on West 46th Street off 8th Avenue up in the Times Square area. I'd never heard of it, but I tagged along. I was impressed when the doorman, Teddy Slatus, allowed me in because I was with the girls and he knew them. They explained to me that The Scene had a policy of always letting the regulars in, and I soon discovered that a lot of nightclubs operated that way, because that's how they developed the kind of crowd and the kind of atmosphere that they wanted. Sexy rock and roll girls at one club, creative artists at another, great dancers at yet another. As my first taste of true New York City rock and roll nightlife, The Scene was a great introduction. It was run by a guy named Steve Paul, and even though it had been open for less than a year, it was already a very popular hangout for visiting musicians. You'd never have known it was there unless you already knew about it. The door opened directly onto the street, and really it was just a doorway, nothing fancy, nothing to let you know what happened behind it. First, you descended a staircase that opened into a kind of reception area or an anteroom. There was a bar area, and in the middle of the bar on the left, there was an opening into the larger room where the stage was. There was seating towards the back, and old worn-out banquet seats, and for some reason, my favorite became an especially worn banquet with a hole in the seat as if somebody had burned through it or burrowed. I don't know why, but I loved sitting there. Sinking down into the hole, I could see the whole room, and I just stared at everybody and wondered what was going on. Because I was still new to New York City, I didn't really know anybody, and certainly nobody in the music scene. I don't even remember talking to anybody there, except one time when I was with my friends Hank Aberley and Al Lax, who Mike met in the Village one day. I took some pictures of them there that night in a room lit only by candles. And that was important, because it was my first time I figured out how to take a picture in light as dim as candlelight. Having learned how things worked at Steve Paul's Scene, I started applying the same principle to other clubs, getting to know the doormen and doing what I could to be helpful to the venue, usually by taking pictures there and publicizing the club. Later, I'd even be publicizing the club owners by getting their photographs into the different magazines I was working for, and they loved that. Meanwhile, another type of connection with music developed for me. Hank and I were musicians, and soon after we met, Mike and an old high school friend of ours named Tom Weiner started their own folk rock band, the Justice League. Everyone clicked. I had the use of my dad's station wagon for hauling the equipment, and I could also take pictures of the band. Basically, I was a roadie with a camera. It also turned out that I was only one of us who could remember all the words to Like a Rolling Stone by Bob Dylan, and once in a club, and once at the World's Fair, I got up on stage with them to sing it. That was the extent of my singing career. I wasn't comfortable in front of an audience. Like a lot of photographers, I guess, I was happier behind the camera. It made me nervous to have everybody staring at me. Over the years, I'd get over that, come out from behind the camera, and develop my own public persona. This was the summer I saw Dylan rock out at Newport. I got good pictures, but I had no contacts at any of the magazines or in the music industry where I could sell them. I wasn't even sure where the offices of the magazines or record companies were. I did look in the phone book for the Manhattan office address of Dylan's manager, Albert Grossman. I took a couple of prints in, just to show them. I didn't get to meet Grossman or anybody famous, but the receptionist thanked me for the pictures, and in return, Grossman's secretary handed me a ticket to see Bob Dylan at an upcoming show. She later told me that Dylan took the prints home, but I never heard anything more. It wasn't until the 1970s that I began licensing my Newport picture of Dylan, which had been published many times since then. Meanwhile, the Justice League was just beginning to sound really good. They were rehearsing in our Sullivan Street apartment and becoming more and more proficient. Unfortunately, our Italian neighbors did not appreciate the music in the same way that we did. Adding their complaints to the fact that we never paid the rent, it's no surprise that just 3 months into our tenure in September, we were evicted. We decided to throw one last big party, and deep in the night, music blasted from our apartment. Suddenly, at around 3 a.m., the doorbell rang. It was our landlady, standing in the doorway with a fireman. "Your car burned up." I had bought my mom's Singer Gazelle, a compact British car. You didn't see many little British cars on the streets in those days, and it always turned heads. It was a black convertible with a blue stripe down each side and red leather interior, a hot little car. It wasn't always reliable, but when the starter motor broke at one point, I couldn't afford to fix it. I had to crank the engine to start it. It actually had a hole in a fender where you inserted a crank like an old-time automobile. I did that for a couple of months, and it was one time in the heart of the village at the intersection of 3rd and McDougal Street when the car stalled as I was making a turn. I'll never forget how embarrassed I was to get out and crank it up right there in the middle of the intersection. People were staring and scratching their heads. But it was a fun car to drive with the top down to places like Newport. Now the neighbors had torched it. All that survived were my two John Lennon books, In His Own Right and the just published A Spaniard in the Works, which one of the firemen solemnly handed to me. They'd been in the glove compartment, and oddly, they were all that was saved from the blaze. The singer itself was a charred hulk. The Justice League was having fun. They were just a bar band making $25 a night, but audiences seemed to like them when they played. They were now rehearsing at Tommy's house in Great Neck, and one day in November 1965, we were hanging out there when our friend Davey Simon arrived. He was accompanied by a guy he'd met walking down the street, who was looking cool and carrying a guitar case. Davey accosted him and said, "Hey, do you want to be in a band?" The guy said yes, so Davey brought him by. His name was Larry Coryell, and he looked amazing. He walked into the basement, and we were immediately impressed. A very good-looking guy with perfect Hollywood hair. He was a couple of years older than me, and he explained that he had come to town to attend Mann's School of Music. When he opened his guitar case, all the air went out of the room. He had a $3,000 Guild guitar in there. We were in awe. He started playing these pearly notes just hanging in the air. He was better than anybody in the room. He was better than anybody we had ever heard. He was just phenomenal. Everything about Larry seemed impossibly exotic. One day when the band was rehearsing, we took a break to have a bite to eat, and Larry had a bottle of brown rice with some vegetables in it. When Larry told me about his diet, it was the first time I heard the word macrobiotic. He had a terrific sense of humor, and he knew so much about music, as I was about to discover. Larry agreed to join the Justice League, and a few days later they were at a rehearsal space on Bleecker Street. As they started to rehearse, I went up to 14th Street, to Flag Brothers, to buy a pair of cheap Tom McCann Beetle boots, brown suede with a Cuban heel and a zipper up the back. I saw a crowd of kids on the street outside the Academy of Music gathered around a girl I knew, Freddie Taylor. I asked her what was going on. "It's the Rolling Stones," she said. "Want some tickets?" I said, "What's the Rolling Stones?" "It's a band from England. They're fantastic." I had never heard of the Rolling Stones. Musically, my world was bound up in the folk scene. I had never heard of a rock band playing in a theater either. I thought rock bands only played in bars and at dances. The whole concept of a rock band giving a concert in a theater was new to me, and somehow exciting. I had to make a decision. I had precisely $10 on me, which was the price of the boots. But Freddie had tickets for the show, which she was selling for $5 apiece, double their face value. Boots or band, band or boots, I bought two tickets. I ran back to the rehearsal loft and asked who wanted to go see these Rolling Stones with me. Nobody. "No, man, we're busy rehearsing." All except Larry. He wasn't feeling all that busy sitting in with the Justice League, so he came with me. As it turned out, he'd actually heard of the Rolling Stones. We sat in the mezzanine, just talking while we waited for the show to begin. Or rather, Larry talked and I listened as he chatted on about guitars and amps and gear of all descriptions. I had no idea what he was talking about. I felt more disoriented at that concert than I did taking LSD for the first time. There was so much noise and chaos. People were screaming, paper plates flew through the air. Bands came and went and made some noise for a while, until finally the MC shouted, "The Rolling Stones!" I heard no music, no singing for the rest of the concert, just screaming. Mick Jagger jumped and jerked around like a marionette whose strings were controlled by a speed freak. Bill Wyman was absolutely stock still. The only time he moved during the whole concert was when a paper plate sailed right towards him and he shifted maybe 4 inches to his right. Keith and Brian were probably doing a good job, but I still didn't hear any music. I just saw this mad Mick Jagger bouncing and jumping and leaping all over the stage, and the audience screaming throughout at the top of their lungs. Larry, meanwhile, was sitting there calmly. I remember at one point he said something about the kind of amplifier the band was using, and I looked at him as though he was crazy. I didn't know how he could stay so calm. At the very end, The Stones played I Can't Get No Satisfaction for what seemed like 15 minutes. Incredibly, I'd never heard it before. No matter that the song had been number one just a few months earlier, for me, it was brand new. And when I got back to the loft and my friends asked me what happened, all I could say was, dom dom, da da da, da da da. That riff stuck in my head for weeks. Larry played with the Justice League for just 3 days, and then he went on to a career in jazz, pioneering and innovating jazz fusion and working with everyone from Chick Corea to Miles Davis. My exile from Manhattan did not last too long. I spent 2 months back on Long Island with my parents, and then I received a call from Alan saying he had found us a new place on West 46th Street. In fact, it was two separate two-bedroom apartments, one over the other. Hank, Al, and I were in the bottom one. Alan and Mike were above. We still weren't certain how we were going to be able to pay the rent, but we thought we'd give it a try. I was able to find jobs that had something to do with photography, including a spell at Stetch & Stetch, a photo studio that took pictures of lamps. It was down on Broadway around Bleecker Street, and after I'd been there a while, I was able to get my friend Al a job there as well. It was boring work. When I say we used to take pictures of lamps, I mean it. That's what we did. We took pictures of lamps and ashtrays for a whole host of different manufacturers to use in their sales catalogs and brochures. My part in this enterprise was to go to what was known as the Lamp Building up on 24th Street and 5th Avenue, a huge place where on almost every floor all the offices were occupied by lamp wholesalers. There you could find every kind of lamp you could possibly imagine. Every lamp you've ever seen in a motel or a hotel, every lamp your neighbors have or you have, whether it's the cheapest model available or the most expensive, they were all for sale in that building. Every visit, I would pick up 20 lamps, put them in the van, and bring them back down to the studio. Then, once they'd been photographed, I'd drive them back and get some more lamps from some other company. My other task was to print out the finished pictures, hundreds of them at a time, on a machine that automatically printed out contact sheets. Put the paper in, take the paper out. Put it in, take it out. Put it in, take it out. Over and over again with this automatic contact printing machine, spitting out up to 150 copies of whatever kind of lamp it was that some company wanted to sell. The Justice League continued their slow rise to recognition in the local folk scene. Hank had even dropped out of school. He'd been attending the High School of Music and Art on 135th Street, but he quit to live with and concentrate on the band. We even had our own following, as some of the girls he knew from school started to come over and hang out. We also started to meet girls at the band's gigs. When I organized a party at New Year's Eve, I made sure to invite all the girls we knew. The apartment was packed, and the cops came twice to warn us about the noise. They came back at 11:30 and made everyone leave. I was alone in Times Square by midnight. Chapter 4, Where There's Smoke, John Lennon, Lisa Robinson. One evening in the late winter of 1966, Alan picked up the phone, and it was Michelle, one of Hank's high school friends, who wanted to come over and bring her sister. Her sister's name was Nadia, and I thought she was really cool. In fact, she was beautiful, with brown eyes and light brown hair. She was sensitive and smart, an art major with a minor in education at Hunter College. We smoked a little pot, got to know each other, and soon we were dating. 2 weeks later, Nadia threw a party at her parents' apartment on 70th Street, just off Central Park. Her dad, Abe Lublin, was one of the biggest publishers of fine art lithographs in the world, and the apartment reflected that. There were three big original Toulouse-Lautrec posters on the wall, a Chagall, and a couple of Picassos. Later, he would publish John Lennon's erotic lithograph portfolio, Bag One. Abe started out as a truck driver from the Bronx. In World War II, he had been the sergeant in charge of the Allied Powers Supply Depot in Paris. If you needed anything from a ballpoint pen to a Jeep, you went to him. He met Nadia's mother, a young French actress, in Paris. They were now away on a second honeymoon, which gave Nadia the perfect opportunity to throw a birthday party for her friend Ronnie Hoffman. That was the night I met Ronnie's boyfriend, Richard Meltzer, a rock critic at a time when there were only a few around. Ronnie went to Hunter College with Nadia, and Richard spent his days watching movies, doing research, he said, for the great American novel that he was planning to write. Whenever Nadia's parents were away, Ronnie and Richard would move into their bedroom. They didn't have anywhere else to shack up. Unfortunately, his great American novel is still up for grabs, but Richard did go on to write a few important books of rock criticism, including Gulcher and the Aesthetics of Rock, and his journalism is in a class of its own. It was a fascinating party for me. Richard's music business friends and contacts were everywhere. Steve Paul, who ran the Scene nightclub, showed up with the singer Tiny Tim, who was carrying his ukulele in a shopping bag. Rock writer and musician Lenny Kaye, who later helped Patti Smith start her band, came, and so did Lisa Robinson, who had become a very important rock writer. They all knew Richard, and none of them knew me. But because I was helping to organize the party, showing everyone where the hookah pipe full of pot was, essential services like that, everybody got the impression that this place was my apartment and that I was some rich, groovy guy with Picassos on the wall. In fact, I didn't have $3 in my pocket. Later, when there were just a few of us left, Nadja suggested we go up to Ontemeyer Park in Yonkers. I didn't know Ontemeyer Park, but I was happy to drive her father's Lincoln Continental there. So Nadja and me, Hank and Al, and some guy we had just met at the party drove off. Ontemeyer turned out to be a wonderful place. It was the former estate of Samuel Ontemeyer, who was a wealthy corporate lawyer in the early 20th century. Originally, there was a 99-room mansion on the site, and while that was torn down in the late 40s, what remained was spectacular. 150 acres overlooking the Hudson, with beautiful gardens, statues everywhere, and a man-made grotto. I've heard stories about some pretty swinging parties that went on there. Isadora Duncan dancing barefoot on the lawn, tales like that. By 1966, the park had sadly fallen into neglect and ruin, like most everything else in and around New York City at the time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.